morning and welcome to worship here in the parish of Wareham. This morning, as always, we have words and music to help us connect in worship with the God who loves each and every one of us. And so, before we come to our first hymn, a short prayer. Father God, meet with us this morning. Make us aware of the reality of your presence wherever we are, and remind us that however we feel as we come, you welcome us all. Amen. And now we sing our first hymn, God is Love, Let Heaven Adore Him. Becoming very aware that every time I take this part in the online service, I say much the same thing before our time of confession, and I'm saying it again because I do genuinely believe that we need to remind ourselves of the perfect goodness of God, of the fact that we are not perfect like God, and of the very comforting fact that we can at any time bring the messy reality of our lives before God and ask for forgiveness, knowing that because of Jesus, that forgiveness will always be given. And so some words of confession. I will say the first bit, and if you would like to make this confession yours, simply repeat when I say, Lord, have mercy. Loving God, we are sorry for the times when we have not acted for the well-being of your whole creation. Lord, have mercy. We are sorry for the times when our words have not reflected your love and compassion. Christ, have mercy. Because of your love and mercy, set us once more on the path that brings life to all. Lord, have mercy. May the God of love bring us back to himself, forgive us our sins, and assure us of his eternal love in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Creator God, you made us all in your image. May we discern you in all that we see and serve you in all that we do. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now we turn to a time of focusing on Scripture. Alan and then Margaret will read our Bible passages to us, and then Bridget will share with us her thoughts on those passages.
The reading is taken from the prophet Amos, beginning at chapter 7, verse 7. This is what the Lord showed me. The Lord was standing by a wall that had been built true to plumb, with a plumb line in his hand. And the Lord asked me, "What do you see, Amos?" "A plumb line," I replied. Then the Lord said, "Look, I am sending a plumb line among my people Israel. I will spare them no longer. The high places of Isaac will be destroyed, and the sanctuaries of Israel will rise against the house of Jeroboam." Then Amaziah, the priest of Bethel, sent a message to Jeroboam, king of Israel. "Amos is raising a conspiracy against you in the very heart of Israel. The land cannot bear all his words. For this is what Amos is saying. Jeroboam will die by the sword, and Israel will surely go into exile, away from their native land." Then Amaziah said to Amos, "Get out, you seer. Go back to the land of Judah. Earn your bread there and do your prophesying there. Don't prophesy any more at Bethel, because this is the king's sanctuary and the temple of the kingdom." Amos answered Amaziah, "I was neither a prophet nor the son of a prophet, but I was a shepherd, and I also took care of sycamore fig trees. But the Lord took me from tending the flock and said to me, 'Go prophesy to my people Israel.'" This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
A reading from Mark chapter 6, beginning at verse 14. King Herod heard about this, for Jesus' name had been well known. Some were saying, "John the Baptist has been raised from the dead, and that is why miraculous powers are at work in him." Others said, "He is Elijah." And still others claimed, "He is a prophet, like one of the prophets of long ago." But when Herod heard this, he said, "John, whom I beheaded, has he been raised from the dead?" For Herod himself had given orders to have John arrested, and he had him bound and put in prison. He did this because of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, whom he had married. For John had been saying to Herod, "It is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife." So Herodias nursed a grudge against John and wanted to kill him. But she was not able to, because Herod feared John and protected him, knowing him to be a righteous and holy man. When Herod heard John, he was greatly puzzled, yet he liked to listen to him. Finally, the opportune time came. On his birthday, Herod gave a banquet for his officials and military commanders and the leading men of Galilee. When the daughter of Herodias came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his dinner guests. The king said to the girl, "Ask me for anything you want, and I'll give it to you." And he promised her with an oath, "Whatever you ask, I will give you, up to half my kingdom." She went out and said to her mother, "What shall I ask for?" "The head of John the Baptist," she answered. At once the girl hurried in to the king with the request, "I want you to give me right now the head of John the Baptist on a dish." The king was greatly distressed, but because of his oaths and his dinner guests, he did not want to refuse her. So he immediately sent an executioner with an order to bring John's head. The man went, beheaded John in the prison, and brought back his head on a dish. He presented it to the girl, and she gave it to her mother. On hearing of this, John's disciples came and took his body and laid it in a tomb.
Amos, in our first reading, was a simple shepherd who tended sycamore fig trees in the southern kingdom of Judah. Nothing special then. A very ordinary man with no qualifications, no powerful job, no status at all, except perhaps the lowest of the low. This can give us all hope that God chose this very ordinary man to warn the people of Israel, the northern kingdom, to mend their ways or face his dreadful punishment. The northern kingdom had for some time turned away from the God of their ancestors and taken to worshipping other so-called gods instead. And enough was enough. In the preceding verses, we learn that Amos' sincere prayers had persuaded God to lessen the punishment, which gives us hope today that God does listen to prayer. Instead, God offers a vision of a plumb line, a tool used even today to ensure that a wall is straight or that the wallpaper is properly vertical. We all know that a bulging wall is likely to fall down pretty quickly, and a crooked wallpaper looks terrible. So a plumb line is a useful tool for checking that something is straight, including, in this case, whether the people of Israel were living by God's rules or not. Needless to say, Amos' predictions of disaster were not well received, especially by Amaziah, the priest of Bethel, who would surely be out of a job if the people listened to Amos and returned to the true God. And Jeroboam, the king who allowed Israel to turn away from God, would either have to listen and obey or, like Amaziah, be shown to be totally powerless. When the leaders are corrupt, the people tend to follow. In our second reading, we have another man who's scared of losing his position of power, Herod Antipas. Herod's power came from the Romans, who had a track record for putting petty officials in powerful positions because they were fairly easy to control. John the Baptist's particular gripe with Herod was the illegal marriage to Herodias, his brother Philip's wife. Herod was not happy with John publicly declaring his sin, and no doubt he felt guilty. None of us likes having our mistakes broadcast. At best, we feel silly. At worst, we thoroughly dislike the person who put it out there. Herodias, of course, hated it even more and was determined to get rid of John. In this story, we have a good example of a dysfunctional family. A weak father who indulges his daughter, a mother who manipulates in order to get her own way, and a spoiled child who was probably only around 10 years old. It seems Herod actually rather liked John and apparently enjoyed talking with him. So although he'd put John in prison to stop him talking publicly, he didn't really want him dead. Young girls often like dancing, and Herodias' daughter danced to entertain her father and all the important guests at the feast. Proud father offers her anything she wants, including half of his kingdom, which was an empty promise because he didn't have one. Being only a child, she asks her mother for ideas. Herodias tells her to ask for the head of John the Baptist. What horror! What can Herod do? In front of all these people, he has no option but to agree or lose face. If he loses face, he loses respect, and with it, all the perks that come with his position. Both these stories are about power. How strong is our desire for it, and how hard it is to let go of it. Genuine power comes from God himself, not from mere human beings. Being in a position of power can trick us into thinking how wonderful we are, turning our back on the God who gave us the privilege in the first place. The real warning underlying these readings is that if there is anything in your life you would not want publicised, then turn to God, repent, ask forgiveness. Put it right if you can, but certainly stop doing it, regardless of what your friends and neighbours might think.
Thank you, Bridget. And now we sing again, or simply listen to the song Cornerstone, sung by Anne and Steve.
Trumpet sound, oh may I then in him in his righteousness alone. Faultless I stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Saviour's love.
Thank you, Anne and Steve. Now Mary is going to lead us in a time of intercession as we pray for those people and situations around the world that we perceive as needing a touch of the hand of God today.
Let us pray in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father, for sending Jesus, your Son, to live among us. We thank you for our God-given talents and the way sport can unite us all. In our yin-yang world, we recognise, share and empathise with the balance of one person's joy with another's despair. Yet as Christians, we must always stand up for truth, justice and show compassion to those in need. In our lives, may we reflect Jesus' love, goodness and forgiveness to all. So Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all whose head is being cut off today. Be it the head of the voiceless, the disposed, the victims of war, the aborted, the prisoners of conscience, those suffering through lack of COVID vaccines. Lord, give us the courage to protest against injustice. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray for all those in prison. Lord Jesus, you spent your last night before your crucifixion in prison. Bring comfort to the thousands of good people languishing behind bars. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we pray that we may grow in compassion for all who are exploited to achieve the ends of others. We pray for all the youngsters caught up in gangs and the county lines exploitation. Those trafficked by immigration gangs. The mentally ill, the elderly, and those caught in phone and internet scams. Give us compassion to all who are vulnerable. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Jesus, you had to suffer to live out the gospel. Give us the strength to put aside worldly comforts and give time to you in prayer, the reading of your word, and act to reflect your love. Give us the strength to make personal sacrifices for you. And unlike Herod, may we never be too proud to back down, to admit our mistakes and ask for forgiveness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And rejoicing in the presence of God here among us, let us pray together with confidence, as our Saviour taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Now we sing our final hymn, Go Forth for God, led by our own choir at Lady St Mary's. It's a great hymn which reminds us that as we leave this time of gathering together for worship, because whenever and wherever you might be watching this, we are together, that we don't come to the end of being the people that God wants us to be in the world, or doing what he wants us to do in the world, but that as we go forth into whatever the week holds for us, knowing that he goes with us, he will guide our words and our actions if we will simply listen to him. And so, as we go from this place, a final word of blessing. The Lord bless you and watch over you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look kindly on you and give you peace. And the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and all who you love and pray for, now and always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, Amen.
Miserere, miserere.